except for this. Ooh, and this. Ooh, this.
Kids, huh?
Canadian Tire lets you give like Santa
and save like Scrooge.
Home hardware, home of the handyman.
Shop Christmas home savers from the Silex Meal Maker 2.
What do you want us to talk about, Mike? What do you got?
Well, I understand that Expo.
Don't ask him, he'll only confuse.
Converts either way in seconds, only $9.99. Help control air pollution with an air cleaner and odor controller from West Bend. Helps trap smoke, pollen, and more. $12.99 during Christmas Home Savers.
Home hardware, home of the handyman.
BCTV, we're giving it all we got.
Good morning. This is Webster. I'm not in my very best form. As you can see, if perhaps you can't see, I have on a careful two-piece suit and the wrong jacket. I now look down and I find I have one blue sock and one black sock. And things are going to go wrong this morning. But my first contribution to your enlightenment and entertainment today is very simple. We have a, quote, peace treaty for the moment between Solidarity and the Social Credit Government of Victoria. There are a number of, said he, choosing his words carefully, orangutan elements on the outer sides of each spectrum, Social Credit and Solidarity, who would dearly love to find a way to prevent any real solution to the present crisis. I'm not going to contribute to that today. Gotta wait till something happens. Something will happen here tomorrow morning at 9 a.m. precisely, because Premier Bennett will be here, as will be his provincial secretary, James Chabot, and we shall put specific questions to Premier Bennett to see what his plans are, not tomorrow morning, Friday morning. Friday morning. I knew something would go wrong. What day is this? Monday, Tuesday. This is Wednesday. Tomorrow is Thursday. Premier Bennett and Jimmy Chabot will be here on the Webster Show Friday morning at 9 a.m. So it can simmer and bubble and boil and trouble as it wishes. Monroe made his move. Solidarity approved it. The ball is in Premier Bennett's court. We shall deal with it in finite detail, hopefully with the Premier, Friday morning at 9 a.m. Now, having said that, I think I've got all my other clothes on properly. I have a couple of casual but very bright, witty, informative guests here this morning. One is His Worship, the Mayor of Vancouver. I will jab him a little bit in politics because he doesn't quite know where he's going in that direction. And the other is a brilliant broadcaster, playwright, author, novelist, an old friend of mine. His original alma mater was the Columbian newspaper, followed by the Vancouver Sun, followed by CBC, followed by Distinguished Public Service for the BC Police Commission. And if you don't know him, I'm not even going to introduce him. But for those that don't know him, put him back again. Paul St. Pierre. Beautiful mutton chops and all. First, though, for His Worship, Mayor Harcourt, after the break. I'll tell you one thing I want to ask you about, Your Worship, Your Honor, Your Lordship, Mike Harcourt, Mayor of Vancouver. You were one of the prime progenitors, if that's not a double positive, of legal aid in British Columbia, correct? Do you admit that?
Yes, I was, but so were you, Jack, and our pal Jack Wasserman played
that's
a very significant role.
This is not an old man's show, no nostalgia. Did you see that decision the other day
Yeah.
Whereby the Legal Services Commission had ruled that somebody with a previous conviction couldn't get the aid. I think it was an impaired charge because there was no money available. And the judge ruled, you know, obviously in accordance with the Charter of Rights, that everyone must get legal aid for every offence for which they're charged. That was the effect of his ruling. What happens now? Who pays?
Well, I don't know the details of it, Jack, but I do know that there's a very good chance the judge's decision was based on the federal-provincial agreement for legal aid, which you and I fought for. We got John Turner to involve the federal government in financing legal aid right across this country. And one of the provisions of the federal statute is that the provincial government has to maintain a minimum level of services, and they'd be in breach of their contract with the federal government if they didn't. So what may have happened is that the cuts, the savagery that happened to the legal aid system, not just for criminal law, but in the civil side also, was illegal. And the provincial government has to face up to a minimum level of legal aid for people that apply. So,
well, they can sit stick in their heels in times of restraint and say, if the federal government wants legal aid under its charter of rights, it can tax the federal taxpayer to supply the money, correct?
Well, they do that. The federal government puts in 50 cents per capita for legal aid. Mm-hmm. Jack, in a depression, which we've got, you have an increase in crime. A lot of it is petty crime. A lot of it is theft, shopliftings, etc. And so you have an increase in crime. You're going to have more of a run on the legal aid system. So what I'm saying is, I don't know the ins and outs of the argument for why the judge made his decision. I'm just speculating that that's one of the things he said. You're in breach of the contract with the federal government. If you want to renegotiate it,
The way I understand it is that every single person faced with a criminal charge on which he is liable to go to jail, I believe that is the distinction, must be supplied a lawyer. Perhaps you would recommend that in the lack of proper financing, that we go back to the old system of the willing horse, the charity lawyer, the guy who is perhaps told in court by a judge, please defend this man. Remember those days?
That's right. Well, my uncle Dougal McAlpine used to be one of the lawyers in town that did that. Harry Rankin, a number of other first-rate
lawyers.
Anyway,
you've got no answers for that.
I don't have an answer for that.
Okay, that was much too nice a way to start. Let's try something else. I hear that Bill King, ain't too fond of railroading, and may well run for the leadership of the NDP. If that happens, you, of course, would you drop all aspirations to lead the NDP if Bill King is in the race?
I think Bill King would be an excellent candidate. He, I understand, is still thinking about running for the leadership of the NDP. The convention is May the 4th, so people have got lots of time to think about it. As you know, there's already three or four people who have declared that they're running. I've said a very definite maybe, Jack, a very definite maybe for the last couple of months.
Mike, you can't run for the leadership of the NDP, and you know that perfectly well. And shall I give you the reason?
Sure.
Because you are dedicated and devoted to Expo 86, which you regard as the greatest jewel in Vancouver's crown, what we're building up through the next 4 years, and you are committed, I'm sure, to be mayor of Vancouver in 1986, to see through the glories of Expo.
Well, I agree with you that the next 3 or 4 years in this city are going to be the most exciting of any city in the world. We've got our city centennial in 1986. We've got Expo happening in 1986. We've got most of the major projects coming together very nicely. This city is going to go through a very positive transformation. And to be the mayor during that time is going to be very exciting and a real privilege. So I don't disagree with you there, Jack, but as I said, I haven't closed the door on the possibility of running for the NDP leadership.
That's right. And you're very frank about it. You have given us a very strong maybe yes and maybe no.
Definitely.
Because if you leave, of course, you know who will be the next mayor of Vancouver, don't you?
Tell me. Harry Rankin, George Puel, Bill Vanderzelm.
No, Vanderzelm.
Grace McCarthy.
To say about Bill
John
Vanderzelm.
Reynolds. I mean, I get so many names.
That's nonsense. I mean, Vanderzelm couldn't be elected dog catcher in the city of Vancouver. And Grace certainly has no reason to
Listen,
run.
That's not a bad post.
Dog catcher.
I think he'd do an excellent job.
But obviously, the man you would like to see is Harry Rankin.
Well, I'll tell you, the person that I'd like to see is myself.
Ah, you're not going to run for the MVP.
But listen, I think in these very gloomy times, it's important for people to realize that there is a city that's on a roll, a city that works and a city that's coming together. And I want to know what your centennial project for 1986 is going to be. Are you thinking about it already?
My centennial project is to be alive, fit, well, and broadcasting in 1986.
Excellent. So now you're not going to bore us, friends of yours, with the yearly tale that you're going to quit this year, eh? You've just given a commitment to staying on BCTV
How
until 1986?
How dare you say that? I shall give you a very convincing maybe. Mike, we've got to do something important. You are the mayor of Vancouver.
Well, let's talk about some of the projects coming up. BC
okay.
Place is up
How
for
much
rezoning.
Will the taxis go up in the city of Vancouver to pay for Expo 86?
Well, that's one of the things that we negotiated very firmly, no tax increase at all from Expo 86 for our taxpayers, which is very important because if you recall in Montreal, the taxpayers from the Olympic fiasco are paying an extra $160 a year for 25 years to pay off the Montreal Olympics debt. We've avoided that in the city of Vancouver.
Certainly have. And the social credit government deserves great credit for coming in on budget and on time with a perfect stadium, which will be very useful for Expo at a cost of, what was the cost?
$125
million.
Under
that was
budget.
That was terrific by the by social credit, wasn't it?
I think they did a great job.
Absolutely.
And, a matter of fact, I've said right from the beginning that that location is the right one. Build a stadium that can handle baseball. And I think that Elvin Nerod and the Premier
did
a good job on it.
Now, are you now lovey-dovey with BC Place on the zoning for BC Place with very expensive high-rise apartment buildings and a minimum amount of rental housing for lower-income groups? Are you lovey-dovey and is everything happy in your little garden between you?
Well, I think there's been a substantial improvement in relationships with the appointment of Jimmy Pattison.
Ah, Jimmy. Jimmy's the key.
I think that that the change of tone, the better relationships between our staff is already showing up. As you know, December the 15th, we have the first major rezoning for that whole site, eh? The vast majority of which will be rezoned for Expo, and about 50 or 60 acres will be put up for rezoning over a period of about 6 months. We're not going to do it all at once. For housing, office, hotels, park space, a seawall. So it's coming together.
The city's not actually going to build anything down there except its involvement in some of the housing.
We may be involved in some of the housing. But our involvement is as the major body to regulate land use and development in the city. And of course, this is the largest project in the city's history. So we have a very important interest. One of the things we are doing, though, is we're trying to make sure that the housing is housing that's affordable, because most of the people that work in the downtown, Jack, aren't high rollers. They're people that are taxi drivers and waiters and waitresses and clerks and computer programmers and middle-income people. So we want to make sure that the housing is there for a lot of the people who are in the downtown, work in the downtown.
Get the message. More with Harcourt. We'll take telephone calls this morning because I'm obviously off farm after the break. For a question of local interest in the downtown east side, I was very glad to see that the council decided to close it for 2 weeks, and you were against that, the Lone Star Hotel.
I wasn't against closing it down for 12 working days. I was on the information we had from the bankers of the Lone Star. They were going to put them into bankruptcy if they were closed down for a two-week period. And, you know, when you're acting as a judge, you've got to temper your harsh decision on sentencing with some justice, and I felt that 12 working days, either one day a week for 12 weeks or 2 days a week for 6 weeks, would be appropriate because we don't want to close down a business.
Will they go bankrupt now?
We don't know. There's a good chance it
will. Did you vote with Warnock Kennedy on that issue?
Probably would have, except Warnock
wasn't there
yesterday. He's got
a
disc problem.
Speaking on behalf of a number of garbage collectors, and I've been in the business myself on occasion from time to time, I understand you have approved the breaking of the backs of every garbage man in Vancouver by letting people put out up to 5 cans of garbage.
Well, that was the advice of the engineering department itself, Jack, which we do anyways now during the
How about the workers? Gardening season. Are they happy with it?
Well, yeah, it's going to cut down on the complaints from people about having to be charged an extra 50 cents.
Good move.
And the workers having to do it. Well, we'll see. We'll see. I don't think people are going to put out that much more garbage. Most people don't put out more than two buckets anyways, but there are some when they have an extra bit of gardening to do that put out an extra one, and instead of charging them 50 cents and having to collect it, we're just going to let them have the override.
Now, Grey Cup's coming up the 27th. We're all set for
that. You're going to be there, are you?
At the game?
Yeah.
Well, I'll watch it on television.
It's blackout.
What?
No, it's on television.
Yeah, it's the Western Finals blackout.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah, no, I won't go to the game.
Listen, I want to pay a tribute to Jack Farley, who was the ex-president of the Lions, who's the ex-president of the Canadian Football League, who's the chairman of our Grey Cup Festival celebration. He's done an absolutely magnificent job of putting this together. 1,400 volunteers to organize the festival of the week. A great committee, and I think the people of Vancouver should realize that when this Grey Cup works as well as it's going to, that Jack's the guy that helped put it together.
Okay. Go ahead to Mike Harcourt.
Yes, Your Worship. Do you anticipate any conflict of interest with respect to zoning of BC Place, having ridden in Jimmy Patterson's private jet on a number of occasions? I'll hang up and listen.
Well, I don't anticipate any...
Are you blushing?
No, I'm not blushing at all, because I've never ridden in Jimmy Patterson's private jet, so...
You went somewhere to...
No, I
didn't. Somewhere.
No, I didn't.
In somebody's jet.
Well, that was... I wish it was a jet. It was a lousy little twin-engine Cherokee.
That was Scalbania.
Yeah, and it was a lousy little twin-engine Cherokee with somebody sitting on the can. For 7 hours, we had to ride in this thing against headwinds, and I get accused of riding in a developer's jet on the way down to Phoenix to try and get a baseball team. So, no, I don't feel any conflict of interest at all, sir, because I, number one, have never been in Jimmy Patterson's jet, let alone a developer's jet.
Go ahead, please.
Yes, I'd like to talk to Mike Harcourt.
He's
yes,
here. Go ahead.
Yes, I got two questions. This ART track, will it ever come out to Surrey? I'm a Surrey resident.
Oh, well, I think it should, and I'm hoping that the provincial government will make the right decision to extend the LRT from New Westminster over to Surrey. It would increase the ridership about 20% and I think would really assist the people of Surrey. So I'm totally in favor of that, sir.
Okay, and my next question.
Yeah.
Are you going to be running for the provincial election? I've heard you were, or thinking about it.
Yes, I am thinking about it, but I haven't made a decision yet.
Definite maybe. Yeah. Go ahead, please.
Yes, good morning. You touched it lightly on about the Lone Star Hotel. That's the reason why I am calling. I have no particular interest in the place itself, but I thought that the way that situation was handled was absolutely absurd. The man did a wrong. He should have been just told not to do it anymore. He was taken in front of that so-called Human Rights Commission, and he was fined $500 per
$1,000.
And then also the city council closes this place up for 2 weeks. If you take time and go through that place down there, which I did, he runs a very clean establishment, one of the cleanest places down there. And I think that's double jeopardy and bloody revenge by the DEER organization. It's ridiculous.
Mike?
Well, I thought that, as I said at the beginning of the show, that 2 weeks was what council decided to close him down for obvious discrimination, which he admitted. And he's changed his policy since then. There were terrible discrimination by some of his employees against Native people.
Oh, that happened once or twice, whatever it happened. But
no,
the fact is that he was already charged by the Human Rights Commission.
Well, that was the reason, sir, why I was prepared to have the 12 working days closure be done over 12 weeks
in other
or
words,
6
close
weeks.
12 Mondays, quiet day or something.
Yeah, or Mondays and Tuesdays.
Yeah.
The majority of council, well, let's put it this way, 5 out of the 10 wouldn't do that. They wanted to stick with a 2-week closure. So, what can I say?
To me, that's double jeopardy. It's ridiculous, really.
Well, it's not double jeopardy, sir. You've got to realize that in our court system, for example, if you're in an impaired charge, you get in an accident and hurt somebody, you can be charged criminally. You can, secondly, lose your license. And thirdly, you can be sued in a civil court for damages. Now, you can't call that double jeopardy. It's the same thing in this situation where if he had a license violation, he could be suspended by the liquor board. He could, on top of that, be fined by the Human Rights Commission, as happened. And also, the City Council has some ability to regulate business licenses, and the court recently upheld that on the argument that you're making didn't hold.
Thank you. He had his say. He thinks the council was wrong and vengeful. Go ahead, please.
Good morning.
Morning.
A question to Mr. Harcourt regarding the zoning in Falls Creek.
Mm-hmm.
Wondering what's happening to the status of the marina there. I've talked to architects on the project, to people at BC Place. It doesn't seem to be any definite answer yet, and I'm concerned. I have a boat there, and as you know, the moorage in Vancouver is really at a premium.
Okay, do you have an answer for that at all, Mike? That's a tricky one.
Well, it's up in the air right now, Jack, because of Expo and the requirements of Expo for that site. My hunch is that the marina is going to be moved. They're going to try and find some temporary accommodation for the marina. I'm not sure of the long-term future of the marina, but I can agree with you, sir, that there's tremendous waiting lists for berths in the greater Vancouver area. You know, we've got over 100,000 boaters in this area. And I know it's a problem. I've got some friends in that marina, and they're facing the same situation, but you're going to have to... I suppose, talk to the owners of the marina who've got a lease with BC Place.
And that's really one of the problems in rearranging the whole place for both Expo and their development.
Right.
Okay, it's the best we can do for you. Now, what would a man or a woman from Horsefly want to say to you this morning? Go ahead, from Horsefly.
Yes, I'd like to know, is there going to be a place for people with campers or small trailers down there from the interior?
For Expo?
Yeah, well, just...
For visiting?
For visiting down there.
Well, there won't be in the inner city area, ma'am, because it's just too low-intensity use of land. But there will be in some of the suburban areas of greater Vancouver, and there are right now.
In Surrey?
In Surrey, there's a trailer camp under the Lionsgate Bridge. So there's a number of...
Oh, yes, of course. I've forgotten about that one. That's pretty full. Ma'am, that's the best we can tell you. How are things in Horsefly?
Well, it's raining right now. And I hope you stay on a long time, Jack, because we really enjoy your program.
And so you should. Thank you. I'll be back after the break. You're popular around the country this morning. From Kamloops to Mike Harcourt, Mayor of Vancouver.
Yes, Mayor Harcourt,
yes,
one question, and then I'll hang up and listen to your answer.
Right.
How much money did the operating engineers donate to your election campaign? Thank you.
I really don't know, sir. I don't know. I don't have an answer to that.
All right. You wouldn't want to know anyway, would you?
Yeah, I don't know the answer to
pointless
that.
Pointless question, I must say. Go ahead, please.
Mr. Harcourt, I'd like to know if you're mayor in 1986, if you're going to pass a law for the landlords. Because in Montreal, what the landlords did, they evicted all the people for renovation. And then when Expo 67 came in, they were renting their apartments for $600-$700 a week. I wonder if there's a law going to be passed here for that.
Well, I think there's two ways to deal with that, sir. Is, first of all, to maintain the rentalsman's office and a decent landlord and tenant act, and I'm pretty sure that that's what's going to happen, because even the landlords in this province were saying to the provincial government, for God's sake, don't get rid of the rentalsmen. Don't sick us onto the county court. Bring that court to its knees with backlog of cases. So I think we're going to have a rentalsman, and hopefully we'll have a decent landlord and tenant act so that people can't be evicted for that kind of nonsense. I'm saying that if you had a decent landlord and tenant act, that would, you know, to kick people out for renovations where it's a fraud would be just that. Secondly, we've looked at what happened, for example, in Knoxville, and some of the greedy landlords there kicked out people and then just took a bath because they tried to rip tourists off, and the tourists resisted them, and they took a bath, and on top of that, lost their tenants. So you know, it sounds in theory like it's a good idea, but it sure isn't when you see it in practice. And I think the other thing that we should do is to build a lot of affordable housing, and that's one of the things that Jimmy Pattison and I and Senator Jack Austin are going to be talking to the Federal Minister of Housing about, is let's anticipate that kind of dislocation of Expo and BC Place and build some housing now for the people in the downtown area who are the most vulnerable. So there's lots of things that we can do, including the city's business license authority, to make sure that our people don't get jazzed around like you're talking about.
Thank you. Go ahead, please.
Yeah, Mayor, Mayor Harcourt, is there any chance that downtown Granville Street is going to be changed by Expo 86? Or?
Well, I think what's going to happen along Granville Street, and it's going to become abundantly apparent in the next 3 or 4 years, is a total redevelopment of the south end of Granville Street. The Grosvenor Hotel is coming down very shortly, and that whole block is going to be redone. There's two other major developments that are happening along Granville Street, and the impact of BC Place and the development of Yale Town is going to become apparent. And I think a lot of the sordid people and businesses that are down there right now are going to change.
Oh, good.
Thank you. You and I had agreed that the dreadful scandal was putting Vancouver downtown underground in the first place, haven't we?
Well, we opposed that back in the early 70s.
So stupid.
If you turn people into moles, you destroy the street life. Not only that, but one of the things that happened, Jack, is that some of the landlords, when we put it in the mall, got greedy, and they tripled the rents. They lost their tenants. Mm-hmm. You know, you've just got to use some common sense when you do these sorts of
things. Go ahead, please, to Mike Harcourt.
Court, with regard to transportation into the inner city, I live in North Van, and we have a terrible transportation problem. I am over 60 and one of the very large number of women riding buses, and I find that there is women riding buses, older people and children, and they're talking of stopping the buses because of the C bus. And if they do that so you can have your all your transportation in Vancouver, you are taking away things that, well, you've already taken away a lot. I have a terrible time getting to the city now, and I used to be able to travel quite freely.
Is there a real problem with North Van transportation of which you are aware, Mike?
Well, I don't know whether anybody's been making it anyone aware of
but
it.
But there's no talk about taking off the buses and making people travel on the C bus.
None at all. As a matter of fact, we're trying to increase the bus service in the sense of certain lanes that are exclusive for buses, better access to the Lionsgate Bridge, widening of Georgia Street. We're on top of that, ma'am. We're trying to improve the service to the C bus. Matter of fact,
I don't want to go to the C bus.
Well, I know you don't.
Walk up and down steps.
Well, listen, ma'am. Let me finish.
I want buses.
What we're trying to do is to improve not only the bus service and access over the Second Arrows Bridge and the Lionsgate Bridge. We're also trying to improve the access to the C bus, and we're also in our plans is the construction of a third C bus.
I don't want C buses. I think,
ma'am, I know you don't want the C bus, but there are a lot of other people that do. What we're trying to do is to get
older people don't, and it's older people that are riding the buses.
You didn't
want buses over the Second Narrows and First Narrows.
Well, I think I made that point twice already, ma'am, that we are trying to improve both services, both the bus service over the bridges and the C bus.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am. I mean, she just doesn't want to travel on the C bus.
Well, I'll tell you, if she's a senior citizen, she's a pretty spunky one, and she's got her point across. We are trying to improve the, as I say, both services, Jack.
Go ahead, please.
Mayor Harcourt.
Yes, sir.
I don't agree with your thinking on low-cost housing.
Well, I didn't say low-cost housing because it's not low-cost. It's suitably constructed
affordable housing.
I'm talking affordable housing.
That's what you're saying, but you are trying to get more low-cost housing in very desirable land. Now, this thing has happened in the University District, too. Where the NDP wanted to put in low-cost housing up there. Now, my thinking is this, that we should put in the best housing that we could possibly put in, that is the developers, that they can rent or sell. Mm-hmm. Now then, if people move into that housing, they're leaving vacancies for lower-cost housing.
Well, you are reflecting the BC Place philosophy with which Mr. Harcourt is attempting to battle on a reasonable basis to make a sufficiency of affordable housing in the BC Place complex.
Yeah, what we're talking about, Jack, is a mixture of housing, some higher income, some for the middle, some for the low.
He says you're wrong.
Well, I think he's wrong, and the developers are telling him that and BC Place that there just is a very limited market for the highest cost housing. And Vancouver is unique in this sense, Jack, that we have a downtown where the professional and executive communities have at least 10 neighborhoods that they can move into within 15 minutes of the downtown. which is quite unique from a lot of other cities.
There's one question to finish this. You have not yet come to an amicable understanding with BC Place on what precise developments in the way of housing will take place on the government land. Is
right.
that correct?
Thank right. you. That's what's going to take place over the next 6 months. But to reply to this gentleman, because it's an important point, he's saying basically that the lower income people should live out in the farmlands in the Fraser Valley, where it's low-cost land. But what he doesn't realize is that those people, a lot of them work in downtown Vancouver. So what you've got to then do is to build a very expensive transportation system, either a freeway or heavy rapid transit, which is probably far more expensive than having some of that housing being in the downtown area.
Fair enough. I understand you clearly and lucidly. One more segment with His Worship after the break. No more long distance calls for Michael. Okay, we'll take one next if you like. Go ahead, please.
Yes, I'd like to ask Mayor Harcourt what progress is being made these days in getting Vancouver a Major League Baseball team.
Good question. There is a very important set of meetings in Nashville beginning of December, the winter meetings of Major League Baseball that people from BC and Vancouver will be going down for. I have said that if I could be of assistance, I'd be prepared to go. I've talked to
who's going to buy the team?
I think the likely people would be Molson's and Jimmy Pattison.
Molson, Jimmy.
Yeah.
Is this this American Rounders we're talking about?
We are talking baseball, Jack. Yes, baseball, American Rounders. Cricket in the dome. I can just see it. The other cities that are going for it, there's one from Florida, there's Denver, and there's Indianapolis. So there's some pretty stiff competition, and they're going to put on a big splash. So we're hoping to go down there and make our presence known so we can have a baseball team here in Vancouver.
We should have.
We should have. Sure, we should. It's a good sports town.
Yeah. We've got a kind of part-time hockey team up one
no,
day.
No, they're doing okay. I saw that game against the Canadians. And
everybody can beat Montreal now. You got a scratch team from BC TV here that could beat the Montreal Canadiens. I'll tell you. Paul River, go ahead, please.
Mayor Harcourt.
Yes, sir.
I think you should make the firm decision on becoming the leader of the opposition. Now, the reason I say this, and I don't vote NDP, is because you've had this experience of running the third largest city in Canada. This would enhance your ability as leader of the opposition, and who knows, maybe the premier. However, there's only one problem. And that is because you're NDP and in bed with the unions. And we all know that the problem with BC today is, and in Canada, is our unions. Not the provincial government or not the federal government.
Okay, you've made your point. It's perfectly clear. I know what you're saying. Did you go to bed with a union last night?
Well, my wife does belong to the BC Teachers Federation.
He is in bed with the unions.
And I think that this gentleman has raised a point that's just dead wrong.
I don't want to get into that this morning,
Michael. I don't either. Well, I'm just saying that he's dead wrong. We've got a situation in this country where we've got to mature, where we've got to have better labor management relations.
Yeah.
And we don't have any slack in our economy in this very competitive world for the kind of wastage that happens because of poor management labor relations.
Good.
So
the guy we need to improve labor relations in British Columbia is Michael Walker. Go ahead from Nelson.
Yes, to the mayor. I would like to put to you, how much is this costing the rest of the residents in B.C. here for this B.C. place and the Olympic Games?
Expo 86, you mean, sir?
Yes.
Well,
B.C. place is entirely financed by the provincial government.
Well,
am I correct?
It is, Jack, but the gentleman should realize that over the 20, 30-year history of this project, it is going to return... if it's developed properly, it's going to return a great deal of tax revenues to the people of British Columbia. And it's not going to be a burden on the taxpayers. As a matter of fact, it's going to do something unique. It's going to provide us with this dome stadium. And if the development rights are sold and it's done properly, those development rights are going to pay even for the stadium. Now, the Expo 86 is going to be paid for by a license, sale of licenses, by admission fees, and by the lotteries. And the purpose, as I understand it, is for the fair to break even so that it does not cost the taxpayers any money.
I must get Jimmy Patterson on about this.
Question, though, what is it costing the rest of the residents of BC?
Well, I just told you, sir, that it should not, if it's done properly, cost the residents of
British Columbia
any money.
In other words, it should return in revenue sufficient to balance the books of Expo 86 if the exhibition is a success and everybody goes two or three times from within the Washington, Oregon, Vancouver, Alberta area. Correct?
Right.
Right. Thank you, sir. We will, I trust, have a brand new Cambie Street Bridge for Expo 86.
Well, I sure hope so, Jack. I think that present bridge is a disgrace, it's dangerous, it's old, and I'm hoping that we can make a decision in the next few months to get on with building a new Cambie Bridge.
Good. You and BC Place will come together. You'll be in bed with BC Place on building a new Cambie Street Bridge. You must, Michael.
No, we can't. What we've got to do is to get on with the rezoning of BC Place, and as well, build a new Cambie Bridge.
Yeah. Go ahead, please.
Yes, hi, Mayor Harcourt. First of all, I'd like to encourage you to become leader of the opposition and probably of the province. And then I'd like to know, when are they going to finally decide to name BC Place, or should I say give BC Place an official name, or if it's going to be stayed called BC Place? Thank you.
Thank you.
My guess is it's going to stay as BC Place. There's been a recognition of the other two alternatives that have been suggested, Elvin Nerod, with a major tribute to Elvin in the stadium itself, a recognition of Terry Fox with the Terry Fox Plaza in front of the stadium. So my guess is that it will stay as BC Place, and I agree with that. It is a place for British Columbia. And I've said right from the beginning that Vancouver is downtown British Columbia and everybody should be welcome in our city.
Go ahead, please.
Oh, Mr. Harcourt, I understand that you're in favor of the LRT going out to Surrey.
Yes. Yes, I am, ma'am.
Okay, I'm just wondering if you're just as in favor of Richmond residents having an off-on-ramp bridge on the Arthur Lang Bridge.
No, I'm not, ma'am.
You're not?
No.
Is there any reason why?
Yes, there is. That our city, and not just the city council members, but the provincial representatives, Stephen Rogers, and Russ Fraser, and the federal MP for Vancouver South, John Fraser, all of us are representing the wishes of our people in South Vancouver, that they've had it with increased traffic through their streets because of all the bridges that have been put across that river. And we're concerned that if we did allow the ramps to go ahead for the Arthur Lang Bridge, that it would lead to a twinning of the Dinsmore Bridge, which would throw even more traffic onto Granville Street and Oak Street, which are becoming de facto freeways, and that's destroying the integrity of a lot of the neighborhoods down in the south area of Vancouver.
Let me hold on for a second. Hold on now. Are we talking about this ludicrous comic opera thing that's gone on because old WAC didn't like Arthur Lang particularly when they built the bridge to the airport?
Right.
You can't use it to get to Richmond unless you go to the airport, turn left in the middle, come back, go around, whittle, fiddle about for hours.
Yep.
Is that not crazy?
Well, maybe crazy, but I'm saying that the people of South Vancouver...
You are against any direct through ramps which would lead to Richmond because it would cause a residential areas to deteriorate and the quality of life in Vancouver to suffer.
Right.
Clear enough anyway, isn't it? Go ahead, please.
Yes, Mr. Harcourt.
Yes, sir.
I just wanted to ask you a quick question concerning Falls Creek and the Cambie Ridge. Has there been any thought given to filling in Falls Creek as far west as the bridge and eliminating the bridge?
I don't think so. It's a very, I think it's going to be a very great asset to the city of Vancouver and the people who visit here to have Falls Creek as a water body and to clean it up so that people can use it like we do Lost Lagoon, use it to boat on, to swim in, stock it with fish so kids can go fishing there, and we do that out of Granville Island.
Yeah,
so I'd like to see it stay as a body of water. I think it's far more attractive, and then have a sea walk all the way around Falls Creek so you can jog all the way from the University Endowment lands to Canada Harbor Place.
Yeah, but that would provide a lot more land for low-cost housing, and also at the same time, wouldn't it be cheaper than building a whole new bridge and all those approaches?
No, it would be far more expensive, sir. We've checked into that, and it would be many times the cost of a bridge.
Thank you, Your Worship, for a lucid, humorous, pleasant report, and your definite maybe on running for leadership.
Enjoyed it, Jack.
Thank you very much, then. Are you going to meetings this morning, or are you going to play golf in the rain?
No, I'm going to, first sunny day we get, you and I are going to go out and slug around with my dad.
Regardless.
You got it.
Next, Paul St. Pierre on Smith and other events. Tales of the Chilcotin. After the break. My friend Steve Bush of the Vancouver Sun took the cover picture on Paul St. Pierre's book, and this has been reviewed as one of the best books of fiction printed in Canada in some considerable time by some guy, I think his name was Bolan in St. Catharines, is that right?
Mm, that's true.
And is there a story attached to Steve Bush's picture, because it's a great picture?
It's a great picture, yeah, recently, a typical story of that country. I want to get a similar picture by Steve for Breaking Smith's Quarter Horse, which is coming out in reissue next spring. So I phoned a friend of mine up there, George Palmentier, who rides in the rodeos. I said, George, will you get on a bucking horse for me on November 26th? I want a picture of a man and a horse bucking. Yeah, all right, Paul. He says, only one thing. He says, I just got piled by a horse in Denver, and they think my neck might be broken. Oh, well, I said, we better not do that. No, he said, I'll buck one out for you. I'll buck one out for you.
Complete with broken neck. What gave you this lifetime of involvement and love of the caribou and the cowboys and the Chilcotins?
Oh, they're a little...
Where did it all start?
They're a little different from most of us, Jack. They know who they are. They make apologies to nobody for what they do. They don't ask anything from the rest of the world, and nothing is exactly what they get. They're their own people. They're among the last independent people left in Canada. The rest of us are all collectivized.
You mean by that, these people? You're talking about the natives of the Chilcotins?
Yes, I am. The frontier people. What's left of a frontier, it's up there. There's no real frontier left in Canada now, you know.
Because we get down on the lower mainland here, the desperate, pathetic, single-minded view of nothing but disaster and tragedy for the native peoples. And many people still get annoyed, for instance, when they see the little pitch-and-putt golf course in West Vancouver going back to its rightful owners because it was stolen from them in 1918 or something. How do you change public attitudes by this kind of...
Public attitudes have changed. I'm not trying to change anybody with this book. I'm writing for entertainment. I don't preach. If I'm going to preach, it'll be a different kind of book. I believe in telling stories. But, all right, for the native Indian in this province, yes, he's had a bad deal for a long time. He is still in a very depressed state in the Chilcotin, very much so. The thing that has changed is the rise of young leadership. In the days when that book was written, of which it's written, the 1950s, they were extremely unsophisticated. Most of the older people could speak very little English. There was no bright young men in the reserves. I would say there's not a reserve up there now that doesn't have either a chief or a chief executive of some sort or a band manager who knows how the rest of the world works.
In other words,
he can cope with it.
There has been sufficient education of not necessarily of selected, which has produced competent leaders who can cope with the white man's bureaucracy.
Oh, don't get me on bureaucracy. Don't get me on the parasitic growth of society. Let's talk of cheerful things.
All right, you talk of... I remember your first one was Old Antoine. It was a very
Dan
ancient Chilcotin Indian. And that, of course, was Dan George in... What was the series called?
Well, that was the Caribou Country series on TV.
You and Phil Keatley.
Phil Keatley did them. And as long as we weren't interfered with too much by Toronto CBC, we got out a pretty genuine sort of a show.
Mm-hmm. Now, the likes of myself, I've only once driven from here to Ballycoola.
Mm-hmm.
And why I haven't done it 1,000 times, I don't know, because that was the land in which you have spent much time, correct?
You can go up in a weekend now, you know, the way the roads are.
Up and down in the weekend.
You can. It's all driving, but you can.
Now, but this Chilcotin, too, with your cowboys and your friend, what's the name of the guy with the broken neck?
George Parmentier. I don't think his neck is broken, but he's taking treatment.
Taking treatment.
He got filed in Denver anyway.
These days are numbered. Surely they're numbered.
Oh, they've been saying the days of the cowboy and the rancher are numbered since 1850, and they're still here. They're always going, but they're still here. The style of ranching changes a bit. The style of living doesn't change that much. They've got a particular attitude toward life, which you may like or you may dislike, but it's theirs.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And they have it.
I really have no knowledge of it, because any time I've gone, I've just gone to do a story out again, you know. And you might have a drink with a couple of people, and that's all you know.
They've got their own way of talking, their own style of talking. My wife and I were up at a ranch, two or three weeks ago now, on a weekend.
Do you still have a place in the Caribou?
No, not anymore. I had the Queen for a landlord, and I don't want to deal with government landlords anymore. I've got a place in Mexico instead where they treat me better.
You're joking.
Yes,
I
have.
You gave up your crown lease from Her Majesty because you didn't want to be treated by bureaucrats. So as a good
All right,
Canadian...
That's true. And I've taken up one in Mexico.
Well, you get better treatment with fewer problems and lesser bureaucracy.
Bureaucracy is going to strangle us all, Jack, in this country, unless it can be brought under control.
Well, you're still a fairly young man, Paul St. Pierre, and you were a newspaper reporter, editor of the Vancouver Sun at one time. Did you ever feel, as editor of the Vancouver Sun, that you managed to change the course of human events with powerful, strong editorials?
I could never tell. That was the great difficulty of it. You never really knew if you were having an effect or not. A carpenter builds a house, and when it's through, he can look at it, and he sees it, and he knows it's good, or he knows it's fair, or he knows it's poor. Editorial writing, a little bit like politics. You never really know if you're accomplishing anything or not.
No, I know. I'm filled with that feeling day after day on occasion. But at the same time, you did take a job, and I was surprised to see you take it, but you did a good job on it, I'm sure, as a member of the BC Police Commission. That was a surprising thing, said he, jumping over your years as a junior diplomat. Your friend.
Yes, it was. Well, I've stopped that anyway. I resigned, and I'm never going to take steady work again, Jack. And you shouldn't either. Yeah. One of these days, you know, we all only go through this world once, and one of these days you're going to see the end right up against you, and you're going to think of all the things you should have been doing and you never did, and there isn't going to be time to do them. Or go back to camel herding. You were a good camel herder.
Yeah,
weren't
I was
you?
A good camel herder at one time, and not a bad sheep herder either at one time. But I find that the bones creak a little bit. But on the police business, there must have been great satisfaction in that.
There is, in a sense. I do think this province is as well policed as any administration in Canada. There's faults in the police, and there always will be a few. But by and large, I would say it's first-class policing in this province. And on a reassuring note, I put in 4 years there. I talked to a lot of policemen under circumstances in which they would level with me. I never found any evidence whatever of political interference in policing.
That's good to know.
As far as I know, there is none of this business of telling police so-and-so is my cousin.
Yeah, well, that's very good indeed. Now, one thing before I put you to the phones. I remember you, now you'll correct me if I'm wrong, standing on the prow of an icebreaker in the Arctic when you were what's that name? Parliamentary Secretary to External Affairs.
Yeah.
Is that right?
Yeah.
Well, did that not give you some satisfaction?
That is probably the greatest accomplishment of my lifetime, was the Arctic Pollution Control Zone, on which I led a backbench revolt, as it's popularly called. And that probably is the greatest accomplishment I ever had. Very few people know about it, that doesn't matter.
But I recall that. I remember you being dead in the center of that and pictures of you on an icebreaker.
Yeah.
Is that right?
Yeah.
And that was when Canada arbitrarily established...
Arbitrarily. We set new international law at that time. Now most of the world has come along to the same view, but at that time it was precedent setting. And I had to fight with a band of allies within the caucus. My own party, the bureaucrats, the opposition parties more or less came along, but weren't at first very interested. And it was one case in which a backbencher, which I was at the time
you started
going
it.
On, that I started it, was one time that I think a backbencher did see some results.
6 years in Parliament?
No, four.
4 years?
Yeah.
Enough?
I was retired by popular demand.
Oh, you ran and were defeated?
Yeah.
In the riding of?
Coast Chilcotin. Yeah.
My friend Paul St. Pierre, widely admired for his authorship of Tales of Chilcotin and Old Antoine, etc. Talk to him. Now, after the break. Go ahead to Paul St. Pierre.
Good morning, Jack. Good morning, Paul.
Red camera,
a little bit earlier, you made a statement that bureaucracy is choking Canada, or something to that effect, anyway. Could you give us a 30-second viewpoint on what is being choked and how we can fix it? And if I can make a small comparison, back in the 40s, there was a fear of the yellow pearl. I wonder if we have a socialist pearl today, and maybe you could think on that and give us your views on that, too. Please let me hang up and turn my TV so I can hear everything properly.
You're asking me to say a lot in 30 seconds. When I refer to bureaucracy, I don't refer only to government bureaucracy. I've been around long enough to observe a lot of bureaucracies at work, and the bureaucracy of a large private company is just as inefficient as a government bureaucracy. But essentially, bureaucracy only has the power to stop things from happening. It's got no power to cause them to happen. It is a self-protective organization. It is the safest job to be in the world in spite of what has happened in this province recently. And there is too much power has come to reside in the bureaucracy, which don't know what to do with the power. They're too unassailable. You can vote your politicians out. You can't vote your bureaucrats out, nor can you vote them out of the private companies where they serve you. And for the most part, bureaucracy is essentially parasitic.
And there's no cure.
Yes, there's a cure when ordinary men and women realize how much of their money is being wasted in private and public bureaucracies and demand that something be done about it.
You're right.
Well,
I know.
He said 30 seconds.
No, I'm just saying you're right. I know you're right, but I think it's an incurable monster. Go ahead, please.
Well, it's not only an incredible monster, but let's pursue it one little bit more. Mr. St. Pierre, you have been in politics. You have been a writer. You have had control of one of the most powerful editorial mediums in BC, The Sun. What can we do to create a free press? You've got millionaires like Webster who sits there and keeps his hands in his pocket. We don't have a free press in BC. We don't have a free press in Canada. We're going downhill like you wouldn't believe. Now, is there any reason why we can't get capitalists in this country to not only kick these damn bureaucrats out where they should be, but why can't we get laws that allow investors to make profit? There's nothing the matter with profit. I'd like to hang up and hear your reply.
You are covering a lot of ground, sir. As to the press, it's all things are comparative. As in this country, comparatively, it is free. Sure, there are restrictions on it, which are hidden from most people. The most serious thing that's happened in the press is the lack of competition. And that is an economic development, which I hope technology is going to find a way to overcome, but it hasn't yet. We're into the age of the one newspaper city, and that is essentially a bad thing.
That's
but to cover all the ground you brought up, I'd have to have asked Jack to run over quite a bit on time today.
The specific point you make, though, is that hopefully one day the time will come when this mass cheapening of the microchip and the functions of automation will provide an easier access for competition.
Possibly newspapering can be a cottage industry in 10 years, and we can have again a dozen newspapers in Vancouver.
From Prince George, go ahead, please.
Yes, good morning, Jack and Mr. St. Pierre. I'm calling concerning a relative of my on my wife's side who helped open the Chilcotin area
His name was Dave Wilson, and I was wondering if Mr. St. Pierre might have run across him in his research, anything about Dave Wilson.
Well, I have. I know of him. But did you have a specific question, except that he's doing well?
There you are. Good. From Brentwood Bay, go ahead, please.
Oh, Mr. St. Pierre, why haven't we ever had a rerun of The Education of Philistine, the best and most authentic series we've ever watched?
By all means, sir, let me encourage you to write CBC and urge them to do it again. As a rerun, it wouldn't be too satisfactory as a rerun. They were shot in black and white. They were very low-budget films. If you saw those films again, you would be conscious of technical flaws that you weren't conscious of then in the early days of TV.
What was The Education of Philistine?
That was one of the better-known ones.
Is that the girl who came to Vancouver?
The girl who played Philistine is now in law school in Vancouver, yes.
Was that the one about the cop? No, the copper.
No, the copper's another one. That's Sarah's copper. That's my favorite story. But Philistine was a little girl who's tossed into a white school in the days when Indians were not supposed to attend white schools, and how she coped or failed to cope.
Nowadays, are the schools, what a silly question, they are integrated.
Well, they are integrated, but the textbooks are still white man's textbooks.
Go ahead, please.
Good morning, gentlemen. Paul, just one quick question, if I may. I'm wondering if, by chance, you recall and have written in your, made mention in any of your books, the gentleman by the name of Buck Benny Abbott.
Oh, I knew him well. He was a marvelous man. The manager and the owner of the Maple Leaf Hotel.
Yes, that's right.
Yes. Where?
In Williams Lake.
In Williams Lake.
Have you made mention of him in any of your books at all?
My books are fiction.
Oh, I see.
So when Benny appears, he would appear as a fictional character.
He was a character indeed.
He was a great man.
Buck Benny Abbott.
Thanks very much.
Thank you. Go ahead, please.
Yes, good morning, Paul.
Good morning.
I ranched in that Anaheim Lake country in the 1940s, and I was on one of the long beef drives in 1948 from Anaheim Lake to Quesnel.
Was Lester Dorsey? One of Lester's drives?
No, it wasn't one of Lester's drives. It was, I worked for Bryant. Lord,
oh, yes.
Cyrus Bryant.
Yes.
Did you know him?
Yes. I knew his son, Alfred.
Did you? Alfred's still alive, you know.
Yeah, oh, yes. Still... Yes, alive and well.
I talked to him not too long ago. What I wanted to make the point was what you said about the cowboy and them being their own man. I knew Pan Phillips and Lester Darcy and all those people, and what you said is absolutely true. And when I brought the horses back over the mountains, you had to be your own man.
I think that's part of it, sir. Yeah, the climate obliges you to survive.
That's Anaheim as distinct from Anaheim.
Anaheim is California, and properly, Anaheim should be with an apostrophe, Anaheim.
Is that the one near Alexis Creek or beyond it?
Oh, there's an Anaheim Reserve at Alexis Creek, but Anaheim Lake is 100 and some miles further west.
I was at the rodeo there once, hysterical rodeo, great fun. Take the break and more with Paul St. Pierre. We're talking about Pierre and Smith and other event tales of the Chilcotin. This is Paul, and this is Smith, and this is Webster. And this is a call to Paul. Go ahead, please.
Hello.
Yes.
Oh, Paul St. Pierre. I'd like to get back to the Caribou and the Chilcotin. I spent 2 weeks there this past summer. And I wonder if you remember Irene and Bill Bliss at the Willow Springs Ranch outside of Alexis Creek.
Oh, yes, I know them well.
They spoke of you quite often. One thing I found was really funny. I had read your book, Smith and Other Events, before we went there, and was talking to Irene about it. And she was not very happy with it at all.
No, Irene didn't like it. I sent her a book, and I wrote Unrevised and Unrepentant on the front of it.
Myself, I laughed all the way through it. I thought it was a great story. And I hope you're writing some more.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Rich Hobson is long gone.
Yes, all of the old ones are gone. Rich Hobson, Andy Holt, Lester Dorsey, Pan Phillips.
Go ahead, please.
Good morning, gentlemen.
Good morning.
I'd like to ask Mr. St. Pierre, years ago in his column he wrote about his how to cook a Christmas turkey. There's two things I'd like to know. The recipe's still available, and how are the places you debone the darn birds that you stuck the turkey with?
No, I think you're mistaken there, sir. I don't think I ever wrote about Christmas turkey because I don't like turkey. I ran once or twice a clam chowder recipe.
Oh, I was part of...
No, I can solve this problem.
You can?
The turkey expert is Pierre Berton.
Oh?
Not Paul St. Pierre. It was Pierre Berton who used to run his crazy turkey recipe stuffed with a deboned bird or something.
I don't know.
I can state with absolute authority. Thank you very much. Go ahead, please.
Yeah, hi.
Prince George, by the way.
Yes, Prince George. I was going to ask Mr. St. Pierre's opinion on the opening up of the Mackenzie Grease Trail from Nazco through Pan Phillips Ranch to Anaheim. I understand that when they open this up for tourism, they're going to run a service road parallel to it, you know, to collect the garbage and such, which I think will ruin that part of the country, because then you'll be able to drive right through it. They won't be able to control the service road for service people only.
That's news to me, sir, that there's any thought of building a road. I thought it was a dedication of the trail itself for walking in the same principle as the West Coast Trail.
Well,
Which trail, please?
Well, he's speaking of the Mackenzie Trail from Alexandria to Bella Coola. As well as they can trace Mackenzie's route, he broke his astrolabe or whatever the instrument was, and nobody's entirely sure which way he went.
Did they ever find the rock?
I think, they say they did, but I think there's some doubt of it. There are some people who think he came out at Kimsquit and not at Bella Coola.
Yeah, well, my question was, Pan Phillips was a friend of mine. I realize he only passed away earlier this year, but he was of the opinion that they would be building the service road, and like he said, it's going to ruin it because everybody will have direct access to this part of the country, which now is kind of nice because there is not too much access there. You have to go by horseback or aircraft or whatever.
Well, I've not heard the suggestion of a service road myself.
Thank you, sir.
Okay, thanks.
Thank you. It would seem kind of silly, wouldn't it?
It would. I would think it should be a hiking or horse trail.
Go ahead, please.
Good morning, gentlemen.
Morning.
Mr. St. Pierre, with all your vast experience in dealing with bureaucrats, I just wonder, as a different note, if you've ever run into a manual that probably teaches all of the bureaucrats and employees on how to aggravate the public, and if not, maybe you could ask Mr. Webster to join with you as co-authors to develop a book that would educate the public on what to expect from bureaucrats.
There is such a book out, sir. Jim Boren's When in Doubt, Mumble. I recommend it to you. An excellent piece of work.
Yeah, I can even still quote the Couch line. When in charge, ponder. When in trouble, delegate. And when in doubt, mumble.
Mumble, that's right.
By James H. Boren, B-O-R-E-N, whose first claim to fame was that on horseback from somewhere in New York State to Washington, he rode the mail and beat the special delivery of the U.S. Postal Service by a number of weeks. Great guy.
Yeah,
Canada Customs refused to let him bring in his demonstration parcel smashing machine, which he was going to give to Canada Post. He's an incredible fellow. He's got relatives that live in Burnaby here.
Okay.
Go ahead, from Osoyus.
Good morning, Paul. Whereabouts in Mexico is your ranch, please?
It's not a ranch. It's just a little house down there. It's on the coast south of Mazatlan in a little village, which
you've probably never heard of. When a blue Doberman and a woman used to walk through the woods in the ranch and flush up the ducks for you to shoot? Or the doves for you to shoot?
Well, for goodness sake. Yes.
How are you?
Your name is Happy.
No, it's Lynn Morrill.
Oh, Lynn Morrill. Yeah, well, that was someone else who occasionally flushed doves for me, yes.
But Lynn Morrill, you used to know Lynn Morrill in the Vancouver Sun.
That's right. The same Lynn Morrill.
How are you keeping, Lynn?
Just great, thank you. Good to see both of you.
Thanks, Lynn. Bye. Bye. Go ahead, please. Nothing. I'll take one blind. Go ahead, please.
Hello.
Hello there.
Mr. St. Pierre, I was just reading the prologue in your book, The Chilcotin Holiday. And in that book, you say that there's about the same percentage of geniuses, fools, rogues, wits, etc., amongst the cowboys that there is every place else. But I used to cowboy in Montana, and I want to tell you a story about the most inefficient man I ever met. He got a job digging a well, and he got it so crooked he fell out of it.
That's a pretty good Montana story.
I'd like to talk to you. It'd be worth $1 million to me.
I'd like to talk to you sometime.
Thank you very much, sir. He dug the well so crooked he fell out of it. After the break. St. Pierre writes with an extravagant blend of truth, fiction, dry wit, and warm feelings. That's good. Edith Eglauer said that. She was that wonderful New York journalist who wrote Dennison's Ice Road. Mm-hmm.
She lives up here.
Lives up here, somewhere on the coast.
Garden Bay.
That's right. Go ahead, please.
Yes, good morning. Paul, hello?
Yes, I'm here.
Okay. I'm distracting myself by looking at the dog on TV. I shouldn't be doing that. In any case, Your book, Smith and Other Events, that's just a great book, and I must compliment you very highly on it. Some years ago, when I was a heck of a lot younger, I was up in that country, particularly at Anaheim Lake, looking at some property. Did you ever hear of a lady, an old lady called Annie Punt?
Oh, I just heard the name. I didn't know her, no.
Oh, I see, because I just wondered. She had a piece of land, about 10 acres, including a place called Little Loose Lake on the other side, on the far side, and could have had it for $2,000, and geez.
Oh, there were lots of places now, up there you could buy for less than $5,000 then.
Yeah.
Those years.
Now you couldn't touch it.
No.
Go ahead, please.
Yes, I wanted to ask Paul St. Pierre what he thinks of Indian self-rule. I'll hang up and listen.
Does that question make sense?
Yes, it does. That's the recommendation of the parliamentary committee. I don't know how far they recommend self-rule. Personally, and of course I speak as a white, not as an Indian, I wouldn't want to see Indians running their own foreign affairs. But I think short of such things as that, the more autonomy and the more self-rule they have on their lands, the better. I think we should follow the example of quite a few other countries with Aboriginal peoples and provide autonomous areas for them.
Within other provinces, is that the idea?
Within all the provinces except Newfoundland, where they killed them all.
The Mi'kmaq, was that the Mi'kmaq?
No, that was the Beotuk.
The Beotuk, that's right, I'm sorry. That was that wonderful remark by the senator, as I recall. Go ahead, please.
Paul, I don't know, I've joined late, but has anybody mentioned Charlie Cunningham?
No one has.
Wait, you Charlie Cunningham?
You knew him.
Charlie Cunningham. I know a couple of Charlie Cunninghams, but we haven't raised the subject this morning.
In the Breloran area.
Oh, Breloran.
Oh, yes.
No. Yes, we know of him. White Horse. Go ahead from White Horse.
That's a long name.
Hello, Paul.
Hi.
I was just wondering if any people knew that you've rode in the back of a freight truck at 50 below from...
Oh, that's Red McHugh.
How are you doing there?
You got tired of rolling off the Bellacoola Hill and you went up to the Yukon and you're rolling trucks over there, I suppose. Are you not rolling them over anymore?
We're trying not to anyhow, Paul.
Uh-huh. Nice to talk to you, Red.
Well, I want a little bit more of this. What do you mean riding
Red,
in the back
Red,
of a...
Red McHugh ran the stage, as the freight truck was called, from Williams Lake to Bellacoola. Oh, since Christ was in knee pants, I guess. And then he finally ended up in the Yukon. One time at about 40 below, I got a ride in the back of his truck because the cab was full and there was gasoline splashing all over me. I was too scared to smoke and too cold to care, and that was a bad night, Red.
Yeah, that's a long while ago.
A long while
you
ago.
You wrote about that in the Vancouver Sun.
I don't think I did, no.
You're not?
I don't think so.
Our old friend Lester Dorsey, if you remember, he was very sick that night, and he was riding out with us.
Well, Lester was just out of hospital. He'd had his gallbladder removed, and they told him not to touch fat, but he'd fallen in love with fish and chips, and he ate them all the way up there. So he was in bad shape, yeah.
Yeah, by the way, Lester was up here for rendezvous and stayed with me for a few days.
I know he was, yeah.
Okay, Red, thanks for your call.
Okay, then. Take care.
Much obliged. Prince George, go ahead, please.
Yeah, good morning, gentlemen. I understand your guest is editor of the Vancouver Sun and a police officer for a few years.
Police commissioner, British Columbia Police Commission.
Okay, I just wonder, all through his years in the Chilcotin, if he's ever had any run-ins, like with game wardens, and what he thinks of the system, and I'll hang up and listen to his answer. Thanks.
No, I can't say I ever had any run-ins with game wardens up there. I've known a few of them. I've been checked very seldom. I do a lot of hunting up there, but it's a pretty big country, and game wardens are thin on the ground. Those I've met have been pretty good fellows.
Mm. Go ahead, please.
Hello.
Yes.
Yeah, I've been up to Chilcotin a couple times. It is beautiful country up there. Is there any plans for paving the road up there?
Yes, there is. I greet it with mixed feelings. The better the roads, the more people that come in, and it was nice when the roads were terrible.
You're talking about west from Williams Lake.
Yes, they're paving to Alexis Creek now. In fact, it may already be paved all the way to Alexis Creek.
Oh. Yeah, progress is fine in certain circumstances, providing it doesn't interfere with one's pleasure.
I preferred getting stuck for a few hours going in and having the country to myself when I got in there, but that's selfish.
Go ahead, please.
Hello?
That's you.
Yes. Jack?
Yes.
Yeah. Paul St. Pierre?
Yes.
Yeah. Yeah, well, I was born up in the Chilcotin, all right down in the canyon, down in Farwell Canyon.
Yes.
And my father wrote a book. Well, he's got some, he's memorized of the caribou, or the Chilcotin.
Yep.
And that was back in, 1910. And it's a real interesting, if somebody like Paul could put it together.
Yeah, Paul is a spare time project for you.
Yeah, well, that was Farwell, wasn't it, your father?
That's right, Farwell. Yeah. The old homestead's still down there.
I've read his book, and I stole a phrase from it in this book.
There you are, and thanks very much for your call, but I'm out of time. Best of luck with your new career and with what seems to be a very good book, Smith and Other Events. My thanks to you, Paul.
Thanks, Jack.
Nice to see you again. I'll be back after the break. Famous people, players are coming to Vancouver. You know, they're the magic people, wonderful. And I may have made a mistake yesterday. It's November 29th, two shows at 5:30 and 8:30. And you can get tickets at 2414 Main Street or at the door at the QE Theatre. $8, $4 for kids, $5 for OAP. Famous people, players, black light magic. Tomorrow we're going to do a fairly serious study of the state of high tech and the possibility of growth of it and what it means in British Columbia with some experts on the subject at the BCIT conference. Friday morning, Premier Bennett will be here. And I'll be back tomorrow, 9 a.m. precisely. The future of high-tech in BC, tomorrow at 9 a.m. precisely. No check ID for...
Yeah. Well, I'm confused now as well.
What the fuck am I to get it?